the goodly trees around Jerusalem. If you have your Bible, turn with me, if you would, to the book of Isaiah, chapter 53. Isaiah 53. Isaiah is writing hundreds of years before this event. He's writing hundreds of years before the Messiah would come. Listen as I read verse 3. He is despised and rejected by men, man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. We hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Look at the screens. Could we read this together? Let's go. Here we go. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful for your love and your grace and your mercy that we've sung about, heard about today. Recipients of so great a salvation, we have hope in you. Lord, we celebrate that. We receive that. And Lord, we're so grateful for it. God, open up our hearts to receive your word today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Turn to your neighbors. I'm glad you're here today. It's difficult to be rejected. Two stories, you've heard them both, but for some of you, you haven't heard them. One is funny, one is very serious, not funny at all. Carrie and I were engaged to be married, and we went through some difficulty in our relationship. Can you imagine anybody going through difficulty in a relationship? I know this is foreign to you. And one day I met her at her house, and she took the engagement ring that I'd given her, and she gave it back to me. Now, I'm going to tell you, I was completely devastated. When I walked away from her house that day, I was so low that I really didn't know what to do. I had to recompose myself. I had to reconfigure myself. I had to rethink my future. Have you ever had to rethink your future? Because here's my high school sweetheart. We've been dating for 4 years. We're engaged to be married. And all of a sudden, she decides, hey, hit the road, Jack. Don't come back no more, no more, no more. Well, I left and I didn't see her for a long time. Matter of fact, it was months. And here's another thing. It's hard to believe you can have trouble in relationships. It's hard to believe that I could be in trouble with the law. So I'd come home from school one Christmas break, and I'd come home to mom and dad's, and as soon as I hit Duncan, I got in trouble. That night, they took me to the police station, and they had several charges against me. I think about 7 all in total. I had to appear before the judge. Now, this is B.C. This wasn't last week, just before I was a pastor. And so my name came out in the paper. How many of you know stuff like that happens? They publish your name. So my name comes out in the paper. And Carrie, she picks up the newspaper, and I don't think she even knew I was in town until she read about me in the Duncan Banana. And I didn't live here then. So I'm on the farm and the ranch there at Dad's, and it's in December, it's right around Christmas. So I went down to cut some firewood, and I look walking across the pasture, and I see this person walking to me, and I look up and I thought, that kind of looks like Carrie. And she walked up to me, Cheryl, and she said, what are you trying to do, ruin your life? Now, here's the macho guy deal. How many of you know the macho guy deal? The macho guy deal, I said, well, what is that to you? I've already been rejected. Despised. Well, that's the way I felt. I'm just telling you the way I felt. And I said, what is that to you? She said, well, listen, just because, you know, we've broken up and things weren't good between us, she said, it doesn't mean you have to go out and destroy your life. And of course, you know, hey, I was glad to see her. Really glad to see her. And anyway, through that, we got back together, and then the next year we were married. And we've been married in this June 40 years. So thank you. She deserves a big star in her crown. But going through that rejection was huge to me. I mean, I can still bring back memories of how that felt to me. And then during that time, when I was at school, and here again, this is the funny one. That wasn't funny. Let me tell you, it wasn't funny at all. There was this girl that went to school with us. She was the same class as us. And she had to be one of the most gorgeous girls on campus. She wasn't blonde. She was platinum blonde. I don't know how you get platinum blonde. I don't know if you're born that way. It comes out of a bottle. I don't have a clue. But she's like platinum blonde. She's like Marilyn Monroe blonde. She's like the most gorgeous girl that would walk across the campus. And all the guys would just kind of drool over, you know, she'd go by there. So, you know, about every week we'd see her, you know, once or twice, and they're always saying, gosh, that girl is so good looking. And nobody had the gumption to go ask her out. And so we'd go out to eat, and that would be the topic. And, of course, you know me. I said, well, I'll ask her out. I said, oh, you're not going to ask her out. I said, I'll ask her out. So she was eating one day and at this place there on campus, and I walked up, and I said, hey, how you doing? You know, I didn't have any good pickup lines like, you know, when did you fall from heaven, or you know, anything like that. And so when I went up to her and began to talk to her, and I actually asked her out, and this is what she said. She said, you're not ace enough to go out with me. So I turned and I left, and that was the topic of our guy discussion for a little bit. But let me tell you, the girl I married was much more beautiful than this girl here. Every person's gone through rejection. You cannot live on this planet without rejection. It hurts the worst from people that you love. And it hurts the worst from people who you think you shouldn't receive rejection from. Jesus is coming into Jerusalem. It is the last week of his life on this earth as the Son of Man. He's going to be crucified that Friday evening. He's going to be in the tomb that Saturday. And on the third day, he's going to resurrect. But as he comes into Jerusalem, he comes from the Mount of Olives, crosses the Kidron Valley, and he's making his way up probably to the beautiful gate or the Eastern Gate. We were there a few weeks ago. We actually saw that. It's a fairly arduous journey. Can you imagine the entourage that he has? Lazarus is probably with him. He's just resurrected him from the dead. There's people from Bethany. There's people from the environment of Jerusalem. There's this huge crowd coming up to the Temple Mount. And you can hear the shouts and the cries. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Well, what in the world does that mean? It means save us. We've been under this persecution. We've been under the thumb of the Romans for decades and decades and decades. Let me tell you, the last time they were sovereign in their own land were centuries before. Till the Assyrians and the Babylonians came. I mean, it was one country after another. The Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Medes, the Persians, the Greeks, the Romans. And they were never sovereign in their land. And there is coming a king. And as you heard, it's not the kind of king they thought they were going to get, but it's the kind of king they needed. The king was coming. The king was entering Jerusalem. He was coming to the Temple Mount. He's coming to his own creation. He's coming to the people he spoke the word to, and he was the word. Can I hear an amen? Amen? And that day they were so excited. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, rescue us. We need a Savior, we need a deliverer, we need a king, and certainly they did. And that day, it was a glorious day. The scribes, the Pharisees, the priests did not like it. Tell them to quieten down. You know the story. They said, you know, we don't want this praise. We don't want this turmoil. We don't want this tumult on the Temple Mount. And Jesus turned and said, if they hold their peace, The rocks are going to cry out. How many of you know he's just worthy of our praise? And there's a time to praise. There's a time to worship. And it was the time because the king was coming in. And as he entered, they pulled down those branches, the palm leaves. They waved them. They strewn them in the way. They took their coats off. And isn't it interesting? He rode on a donkey. And it was also prophesied, your king shall come on a donkey, lowly, humbly, meek. He's the servant. And as he came into Jerusalem, it was good for a while, but how many of you know it turned quickly? How many of you know somebody can be on your side one day and they're against you the next day? I am persuaded some of these same people who said, Hosanna, blessed is he who came in the name or is coming in the name of the Lord, a few days later cry out, crucify him. Crucifying. And that's why Isaiah said, he is despised and rejected. Now, what does that mean? They esteemed him unworthy, unfit, not of value. And once something is esteemed unworthy, unfit, or not of value, then rejection. It's like quality control in a manufacturing center or the hospital or wherever you might work. You know, there's certain standards that you have to have. And when they're not there, rejected, rejected, rejected. But what they did not know is Jesus met all their requirements. The prophecies of old, he filled them. His life, his death, his resurrection, his birth, everything about him was right on track. It was exactly what the prophet said all the way from Genesis to the day he was born in Bethlehem. Can I hear an amen? Amen. He's the real one, baby. He's the right one. And when they rejected him, how would it feel? The very people you created doesn't want you. The very people that you came to die for, they don't want you. Now, let's take this not only historical and in our spiritual life, just in salvation, but I want to tell you something. There are people who reject things they shouldn't reject. And you may be here today and say, well, okay, I came as a visitor. I came, you know, with a relative or whatever. This is what you don't want to do. You don't want to reject and esteem things that are value unvaluable. Because there are things that are so valuable that if you don't watch it, you'll get your priorities mixed up. We live in a society, we focus on the unimportant, and we don't look at the important things of life. We are eat up in our society with that. You've heard me say, I want to watch the news, and I'm hearing about American Idol or Dancing with the Stars. I didn't watch the news for that. Hey, that's entertainment. The news is the news. That's not the news. Give me a break. Okay, everybody all right? We have focused so much on the trivial. We have lost the important. There are things in our life that are important. Let me give you a few. Esau, he did not esteem his birthright, so therefore it was what? Rejected. You see, Esau had an opportunity to take the birthright, and as the oldest son, move forward. But how many of you know God knows what you're going to do before you do it? He allows you the choice. Let's not get into radical predestination here. How many of you know he knows the beginning from the ending from the beginning, but he gives you a choice. Esau sold his birthright for a bowl of soup. Birthright Campbell's. Birthright chicken noodle. Birthright chunky beef. Birthright lentil stew. I'm going to tell you, he made a bad decision. You and I can make some very bad decisions. We can embrace the trivial and we can reject the important. And I tell you what, some of us, and I'm going to include myself in that, we get so upset over some of the silliest stuff and then we drop the ball on the real important stuff. And Esau dropped the ball because he did not esteem his birthright valuable, therefore rejection. What about King Saul? You know, Saul, he could have been a good king. I mean, this guy's big, he's muscular, he's good looking, he has king qualities, but there was something about him. He never could follow the word of God. Samuel would say, okay, Saul, this is what you need to do. How many of you know Saul would have a better idea? You will never have a better idea than the word of God. The word of God is always right. And, you know, hey, don't sacrifice till I get here. Don't bring back the sheep. Don't bring back the spoils of war. You know what Saul would do? Right the opposite. He did not esteem the word of God. And you know what? Later, the Lord said, I have rejected Saul. Now, God doesn't go around rejecting people as we would think rejecting people. But you know what? They, and this is what Paul said in the New Testament, seeing that you have judged yourself unworthy. Well, what does that mean? You have lived a life, you have made decisions where you have judged yourself unworthy. So therefore, there are repercussions of not esteeming things, not valuing things, not making it important in your life. You will lose a birthright. You will lose your life. You will lose your position. You will lose your kingship. You will lose all of this because you did not esteem it. Therefore, what comes? Rejection comes. What about the rich young ruler? Lord, what do I have to do to be saved? Well, you know, keep the commandments, honor your mother, father. Well, I've done this from my youth. Jesus says, hey, follow me. Sell what you have, follow me. And you know what? He esteemed his riches greater than the call of God on his life. And therefore, the call goes one way. He goes another way because he did not esteem it the way he should. How about Judas? Judas betrays Jesus. You say, why would he betray Jesus? For one of the very reasons we've talked about in this triumphal entry. Judas, I think in his mind, thought Jesus is going to be a ruling king, overthrow the Romans. Probably he might have been a zealot. He was wanting the Romans to be overthrown, and Jesus was not going to do it his way. I found out Jesus doesn't do a lot of things my way. And he probably doesn't do a lot of things your way either. But let me tell you, if I don't esteem that as value, as I don't see that as valuable, then I am going to see rejection. And it's not that Jesus rejected Judas. How many of you know Judas just did the things that caused him to be rejected? My personal feeling is that what Judas did wasn't much more horrific than what Peter did. What's the difference? Could Judas have found repentance? I think the answer is yes. But the key is, Peter went out and wept bitterly, sorrowful for what he did, and Judas went out and he just wallowed in that rejection. He wallowed in that disappointment. He wallowed in that depression, and he hung himself. He committed suicide. Now, we see Esau and King Saul, the rich young ruler, Judas. Let me give you a flip side of this. This is Hebrews chapter 11. Most of you know this verse. It's talking about Moses. It says, Moses choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ. Now, here's this word esteeming. He said, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked to the reward. You know what Moses is saying? Okay, Egypt, Pharaoh, throne, dynasty, serving God. And let me tell you, when he chose God, rejected by the Egyptians. Some of you young people, listen closely. When you choose to serve God, there's going to be some people in your life that will stamp rejection. You're not my club anymore. Not my group anymore. You're not going to hang out with me anymore. Or I'm not going to hang out with you anymore. Why? Because you've esteemed something that I don't esteem. You've chosen some things that I haven't chosen. It doesn't just happen with young people. It happens with young adults. Happened with Carrie and I. Many of you, when you began to serve God, there were people who you ran with, you went to the movies with, you drank with, you partied with, but as soon as you said, I choose Christ, rejection. Let's put a stamp on them. Poop. They're not our clan anymore. They're not our club anymore. A family can do that to you. A family can reject you. You say, well, hey, you don't know how that hurts. Well, I don't know how everything hurts, but I know Jesus knows how it hurts. He can identify with us on every point. Every point. And you say, well, hey, good thing I'm in church. Well, that's good, but let me tell you, you're not you're not immune to it even in church. There's going to be people that you thought would never leave you or forsake you, would always be with you, and you pull one stunt or you disappoint them or they disappoint you. Sometimes the stamp comes out, rejection. Rejection. And they'll go a different direction. It's just part of life. If it happened to Jesus, it'll happen to you. If it happened to you, it's going to happen to me. And we have to be careful that in those rejections, in those times when other people don't esteem things or we don't esteem things, that we don't make bad choices and miss the opportunity that God has for us. Well, maybe Jesus wasn't coming the way they thought. Maybe he didn't come with an army of swords and staves and you know, all the things they thought he should have. But I'm telling you, he was what and who they needed. And sometimes things happen in our life, it's what we need and we don't know it. It's what we need to shape our character to develop our walk with God. Let me give you a case study here. And I tell you what, this has kind of been on my heart. How about Samson? Let's talk about Samson just for a minute. Now, I can't talk about Samson without thinking about Sylvester Stallone. You know that. I mean, Samson, Sylvester Stallone, Yo, Delilah. You know, it just kind of comes to me. But Samson was a miracle baby. Mr. and Mrs. Manoah has this son, literally sent from God. The angel announces coming. You're going to have a baby. He is going to be a deliverer for your people, for the nation, and he's going to stand against the enemies of God. He came for that purpose. He came for that purpose. But how many of you know, with every calling and every purpose, there's a requirement and parameters that come with it? Well, I got quiet when I said that. Yeah, with every calling, every purpose, there's the parameters that come with it. And so here Samson is. He's growing up, and the Spirit of God begins to move on him. Oh, how many of you are glad about the Spirit of God that moves on you? Samson, he gets of age, and he's a Nazarite. He has certain things that he can't do. He's not supposed to drink strong drink. He's not supposed to touch dead bodies. He doesn't cut his hair. And so now he's moving in the parameters of his calling. And then all of a sudden we see that he touches a dead body. You know, he does the lion thing. And then all of a sudden he sees this woman who's not right for him. How many of you know there's good women and then there's other women? And there's good guys and there's other guys, right? You see, if you make wrong choices, then certain things come into your life. Samson began to make some wrong choices. Aren't you glad that God puts people around you to help you with choices? And you know who they're called? Parents. I lost the younger crowd right then. Parents! Listen, parents! Parents are put in your life to help you make choices. So here Samson is. He's this hulky guy that God uses tremendously. Spirit of the Lord's on him. And he goes after the wrong woman. And dad says, hey, son, I think maybe she's not good for you. And you know what he does? He says, go get her for me. He's calling the shots. I'm going to tell you, when you read this story in the book of Judges, immediately you know this guy's in trouble. Let me tell you, when you quit respecting authority, when you don't respect authority, immediately I are headed down the wrong road. Even when you don't understand it. And I'm going to say something. Even when sometimes they're wrong, God will honor you for respecting it, even if they're wrong. And he says, hey, mom, dad, I don't care what you think. Get her for me. Why would he say that? Why didn't he just go down, take her to Dairy Queen, have a good night out? Because the culture of the day, the parents arranged it. So he needed the parents to arrange the rendezvous because the parents arranged it. And so he says, get her for me, get her for me, get her for me. And so this man of God who has tremendous potential in his life, he starts going down the wrong road. listen, he did not esteem the values, the wisdom, or the counsel of his parents. Immediately, this guy rejects his parents. What happens when you have tremendous rejection? Well, listen, you get caught up in that. And then there's these parameters in his life about not touching the bodies or doing this or doing that. Not only does he reject his parents, he rejects the parameters. And then he goes on, this call and anointing on him, it seems like he doesn't value it. Let me tell you something. If you're anointed to sing or play or to preach or teach or to be evangelistic or work with children or whatever, that is a gift from God. Amen. That's a gift from God. Listen, Samson can get caught up in what he can do. Sometimes we forget the only reason I can do this is because God allows me to do this. And when God doesn't allow you to do that, how many of you know you're just very human and very ordinary, but the call of God, the anointing of God is on his life, and he has ongoing purpose, and for some reason, he does not esteem it. Let me give you something that you can take home with you today, and it's this. Remember when he is upset at the Philistines, and he burns their crops and their fields? How many of you remember that story? Well, the Philistines, they're fixing to attack, you know, Judah and Israel. They're subjugated by the Philistines at this time. And the guys from Judah say, hey, Samson, why'd you do this? You're going to make things worse for us. And the Philistine says, you either deliver him or we're attacking. And the fellows of Judah says, hey, we need to deliver you over to the Philistines, or they're going to kill us all. And Samson said, okay, you bind me, deliver me, but don't you follow me, because if you follow me, things are going to happen. So they tie him up, they wrap him up, they deliver him to the Philistines, and boy, I love this part. As they're delivering to the Philistines begin to mock and jeer and cheer. How many of you know God does not like when our enemies triumph over us? I want you to listen. God does not like it when our enemies triumph over us. And you go back and read it. And when the Philistines begin to mock and to cheer and to celebrate that Samson is delivered, the Bible says, and the Spirit of God began to move on Samson. There are times in your life and my life, it seems like the enemy is going to win. It seems like the enemy is dancing in hell. The enemy is rejoicing. They're down, they're out, they'll not get back up. I've got them. But let me tell you, whenever that happens, the Spirit of God begins to move. Hallelujah. And the Spirit of God began to move on Samson. And Samson broke those bindings. And he looked around and there was nothing close to him. He's looking for a weapon. And the only thing he sees is what? The jawbone of a donkey. Now, isn't it interesting that Jesus rides in on a donkey and Samson is looking for a weapon, and guess what? There's close. The skeleton, the remains of a donkey, and he picks up the jawbone and he begins to, and they said every time he would sling the jawbone, a head would crack. I mean, this guy is cleaning house. And when he finishes, this is supernatural. There's no way he could do this on his own. But when he finishes, I'm telling you what, there were heaps of bodies. I mean, they would come at him, and I mean, he's going with that jawbone. I mean, this is like ninja donkey stuff. It's crazy. I mean, this guy, he's amazing. And when it's finished, he throws it aside, and he says, now I'm going to die of thirst. He said, I have slain 1,000 Philistines, and now I'm going to die. But he threw away the very thing God brought near him. He esteemed it for a weapon, but then he threw it away. And he began to cry out to God. And then he looked over, and as that jawbone lay there, a spring rose up out of that jawbone. Sometimes God puts people and things and opportunities in our life, and if we don't watch it, we'll not esteem it. The very thing he needed, he threw away. The very person you might need, you reject. That's what happened at the triumphal entry. The very person they needed, they rejected. The very thing that Samson needed, he threw away. Let me ask you a question. What in your life are you willing to throw away that you don't realize you desperately need? Could be a relationship, could be a mentor, could be a parent, could be a job, could be a calling, anointing, could be anything in your life. Listen to what I'm telling you today. Do not reject it. And the only way you would reject it is because you don't esteem the value of it. Yeah. Samson's saying, this is nothing but a stinking jawbone of a donkey. Yeah. But in that stinking jawbone of a donkey, there was life, there was spring, there was a well there. He literally changed the name of that place, which means the fountain of crying out. Isn't it amazing? When you cry out to God, God does something. And when I cry out to God, God does something. And sometimes he does it through something I never really esteemed. He does it through something I didn't value. And sometimes we throw things away and opportunities, and we don't esteem things that happen to us even when they were difficult. When we're trying to forget it, God's reminding us of it. When our son died in 2003, our 24-year-old son, that was one of the darkest moments of our life. But I'm going to tell you something. In those years since my son died, in those years since Carrie and I had that death, I cannot tell you how many families I have sat down with and I've looked at and I've had empathy with and I've had the opportunity to pour my heart into them and tell them, I know how you feel. You will get through this. God's grace is bigger than this. His plan is bigger than this. He loves you more than you could ever imagine. Even in the face of death, even in the face of opposition, even when the enemy rises up, the Spirit of God still comes down. Amen. And what I'm wanting to get away from, God is saying, pick it up and use it. Use your pain. Do you know Jesus took the very weapon of Satan and beat him up with it? When sin entered into the world, death came, and Jesus took death and beat up the devil with it. Your hurt, your pain, your disappointment, your tragedy, don't let it go to waste. Don't throw it aside, because it may be the very thing that you can pick up that will not only refresh you, but refresh somebody else. There are people who've spoken in my life that's gone through things I've never gone through. Let me tell you how they knew what to say, because they went through it. They had the pain, they had the agony, they had the disappointment, they had the rejection, they had people not understand them, they had people walk out of their life, but yet you know what they did? They remained strong and faithful, and the Spirit of God continued to move. What if Jesus had got to the beautiful gate? What if he had got to the eastern gate, and when they said, hey, tell these people to be quiet, and he turned around and he walked out and never went back to Jerusalem? How many of you know we would all be in a lot of trouble? What if he took that rejection those days before the crucifixion? What if they nailed him to the cross and he didn't say, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing? What if he had said, Father, make them all crispy critters? What are you saying, Pastor? Sometimes we have to take the pain and the agony and the rejection and take it to our cross. You say, what do you mean our cross? Listen, my cross isn't his cross. His cross isn't my cross, because I could have never done what he did. There's been people crucified before and after Jesus, but let me tell you, it was only his sacrifice, his blood, his atonement could do what only he could do. Can I hear an amen? But I'm telling you, you have your own. And yours is not mine, and mine's not yours. And sometimes we dread it, we shirk away from it. But I'm telling you, sometimes you have to embrace it. And even when you feel rejection, even when you don't esteem it a value, whether it's a birthright or the word of God or the call of God or the anointing of God or a person in your life or even this church, we don't esteem what God's given us. But when we do, when we get past all of that, and when Jesus is hanging on the cross and he says, "It's finished." He didn't say, "I'm finished." He said, "It's finished." Now, do you think the enemy did not want to offend him prior to the act of atonement, crucifixion, and salvation? Could the enemy say, "If I can keep him from the cross, then he will not save these people. If I can keep him away, if I can get people to not esteem him, despise him, reject him, maybe he'll get offended and not go." Let me tell you, he's still doing that today. If he can offend you, despise you, come against you, and then what happens? You begin to walk away from your calling, your anointing, your birthright, all the things that God has for you, and you begin to shirk your responsibility because somebody rejected you. But I'm going to tell you, if you will say, "This is a part of the journey. This is part of the journey. Everybody's not going to understand me." Now, how many of you knew that before I said it? Everybody's not going to understand me. Everybody's not going to embrace me. Everybody's not going to jump on my bandwagon. Everybody's not going to esteem me, so therefore they'll reject me. But that does not thwart the plan of God in my life. That does not keep me from the purpose that God's called me to do. That does not negate my anointing or my calling. And even when people turn and don't fulfill what we think they should fulfill, God is still a good God, isn't he? I want you to bow your head.